Welcome to Talk World Radio, a half-hour discussion of politics as if the people mattered. I'm David Swanson.
This week on Talk World Radio, we are discussing Ukraine, war, and peace. Our guest, Yurii Sheliazhenko, is executive secretary of the Ukrainian Pacifist Movement and a board member of the European Bureau for Conscientious Objection. He obtained a Master of Mediation and Conflict Management degree in 2021 and a Master of Laws degree in 2016 at KROK University. In addition to his participation in the peace movement, he is a journalist, blogger, human rights defender, and legal scholar, an author of academic publications, and a lecturer on legal theory and history. Yurii Sheliazhenko, welcome to Talk World Radio.
Good day, David. Nice to see you. I read your book, War is a Lie. Very topical.
Thank you very much. So for people in the United States and around the world who aren't keeping up, what is happening now in Ukraine? What is the level of fighting and the risk of escalation?
Now in Ukraine, we observe increasing violence tensions in eastern Ukraine. It is conflict which continues last 7 years. According to OSCE, Organization of Security and Cooperation in Europe, we have now very many violations of strengthened regime of ceasefire, which was accorded last summer, but unfortunately both sides violated. There are casualties on both sides, on the side of Ukrainian armed force and on the side of Russian-backed separatist armed forces of Donetsk and Luhansk so-called people republics, which in Ukraine we called temporary occupied territories of Ukraine. It is very geopolitical question how to call it, pro-Russian and pro-NATO commentators use different cliches to describe the situation. We have many discussions about what is perspectives of peaceful resolution, and many experts have not many hopes for a peaceful resolution, despite people of Ukraine on all sides hope that we will achieve peace. It is deep in our hearts.
I certainly hope so. Are any entities around the world helping or hurting? What is the role of the United States and of Russia, of NATO and the United Nations in furthering this war or moving toward peace?
Role of United States and role of Russia is big bosses behind the scenes, because we have this global geopolitical conflict between United States and Russia, and we have Ukrainian conflict as battlefield. Europe and Ukraine for these great powers is like chessboard. They used the local players as pawns. As for international organizations, they of course do a lot. We see efforts of OSCE to monitor ceasefire violations, to help conflicting parties to strengthen regime of ceasefire and to tell the truth about conflict, because if you listen to Ukrainian media or Russian media, it is only the enemy who is responsible for violations. But if you see objective information in OSCE reports, you can see that both sides. Ukrainian armed forces and separatist armed forces both violate ceasefire. This truth is important to understand the nature of this conflict.
President Zelensky was supposed to be a great politician because he was not a politician, however that's supposed to work. And he was supposed to bring peace and common sense and goodness. How is he doing?
Populists promise people a lot, but they fail to deliver. It is a common problem with populists, and unfortunately President Zelensky is classic populist. Because of that, people trust into his promises declined very dramatically. Only after 2 years of his rule, Zelensky promised to work for peace, but we see that he continue this line for not complying with Minsk agreements written in these basic documents for conflict resolution, literally. He interpret Minsk agreements according to NATO and the United States foreign policy political line. Zelensky refuses to have direct negotiations with separatists because separatists are Russian puppets. I need to speak only with Putin, yeah? And of course for this conversation to Putin, Putin say you must comply with Minsk agreements. We have stalemate, and reason for we have it, it is unwilling of all parties in conflict to make trade-offs. When Putin and Biden met in Geneva, we see this outcome. They make this joint declaration. We will not blow us with our nukes. Well, it is good, of course, but no agreement further, and no constructive striving to resolve this geopolitical conflict. United States is in logic of containment of Russia, including weaponizing of Ukraine, using our nation state as weapon against Russia. Do you see this recent American film Out of the Wire? In which this battlefield in eastern Ukraine spread across all Ukraine. We see no state here. We see only civil war. Have fear that some people in Pentagon have a dream to turn all Eurasian continent, maybe except of United Kingdom and some allies in Western Ukraine, into this devastated total battlefield with this militant robots with constant fire, many deaths, and of course they use nuclear threat of Russia to spend more and more on American nukes. It is a disastrous logic of war, which we as peace lovers, as pacifists, should denounce.
Yurii Sheliazhenko, they are also engaged in what they call exercises or war rehearsals, practices with Ukrainian and U.S. and other European militaries. And Russia has responded with its own war rehearsals near its borders, correct? Are these ongoing and increasing still? In the Black Sea as well as on
yes.
land?
Yes, there is ongoing Black Sea drills, and we see that NATO ships have training in armed conflict game with Russia, and Russians respond quite similarly. They have drills in which they monitor and they train to respond to military threat from NATO using military means. We had this very dangerous incident with UK military ship Defender in Black Sea, and we know today it was intentional provocation, and we know today that United States ship was prepared to back in case if Russian military response will be more aggressive. These war games in Black Sea is a very dangerous situation. Instead of seeking ways to peaceful cooperation, agreements about future security of humankind and peace, unfortunately, NATO and Russia train in informational wars and in military drills in Black Sea. Also, we know that NATO prepares to build two naval bases in Ukraine in Black Sea. And it is also quite disturbing because for Russia, as we know, it is a question of existential threat in words of Putin. And indeed, these tensions promise no good to Ukraine, to Russia, to the United States, and to
Europe. Is Ukraine conscripting people into its military? Is it allowing conscientious objectors to object? Is it allowing people to speak openly against war?
Yes, interestingly, conscription in Ukraine was introduced in Russian Empire and very developed in the times of Stalin's Soviet Union. We know that Stalin, for example, repressed religious communities, which demanded right to conscious objection to military service. Hiraki Kuromiya wrote about this very interesting book. We have this post-Soviet system of conscription, of quite violent system of compelling young people to participate in army, to participate in this system, this machine of war, we formally have alternative service. It is a constitutional right for religious people who denounce violence because of their faith not serve in army, but it is discriminatory system because have a right to conscious objection to military service, you should belong to one of 10 churches listed in governmental decree. Very little people belong to this churches. For secular pacifists, there are no arrangements for conscientious objection to military service. There is a punitive term of alternative service. If in army you should serve 18 months, in alternative service you should serve 27 months. When this conflict in eastern Ukraine started, our state proclaimed mobilization, and many opportunities for alternative service were intentionally abolished. Ruslan Kotsaba, president of Ukrainian Pacifist Movement, made a video in which he denounced war and called for people to use their human right to conscious objection to military service. It was in 2015, he was arrested. He was tried for treason and for obstruction of activities of armed forces. He was in prison almost a year, his trial is ongoing because prosecution demands more than 10 years and confiscation of property because of his so-called crime. Just call for realization of human rights to conscientious objection. Court acquitted Ruslan, but higher courts quashed this verdict. Every trial, court in which Ruslan is tried is surrounded by far-right extremists. They constantly attack, physically attack him. For example, 22nd of January this year, they attacked Ruslan and his lawyer Tatiana Montian and his mother, they beaten him. 25th of June, several days before, they assaulted Ruslan and poured on him brilliant green chemical, so-called Zelenka. It was penetrated to his eye. It was a chemical burn of retina, so Ruslan lost his sight on one eye. And ophthalmologists tried to save him, but it was disastrous harm. Several days he even can't open his eye, now this scandalous situation is under criminal investigation, police started an investigation of this incident as simple hooliganism, not as hate crime, as it is, of course, is. European Parliament, I'm sorry, Council of Europe's platform to promote the protection of journalism and safety of journalists, published information about this incident, and of course the Ukrainian Pacifist Movement and many civil society organizations in the world, such as European Bureau for Conscientious Objection, War Resisters International and others, demand objective investigation. And of course these neo-Nazi assaulters, such as right sector, should be took into account for say, assault.
Yurii Sheliazhenko, what is the strength and influence of these neo-Nazi groups in Ukraine now?
You know, first of all, you should understand that ethnic nationalism sentiment is very strong in Ukraine and in Russia. It is increased level of violence in our society, it is used by United States and by Russian governments to promote their war agenda. In Ukraine, we had these neo-Nazi groups were participated in violent overthrow of government in 2013-2014. Of course, we know this catastrophic massacre in Odessa. Such people as Sternenko, which participated in street combat responsible, according to many evidence, for killings, for kidnappings, and so on. Try to wash their reputation. They pose as civic activists, and they have support on political level. Sternenko says that President Zelensky even proposed him to head the Security Service of Ukraine office in Odessa. After assault on Ruslan, Sternenko recorded a video blog praising those who attacked Ruslan. Among separatists in so-called People Republics of Donetsk and Luhansk also are Russian neo-Nazi, which is also a well-known fact. It is very disturbing that those who profit from war use this ethnic nationalism to militarize societies and to turn people into army to fuel
their war machine. It's always been stunning to me for years and years now that in the United States, if you speak against militarism or war spending, the reply is always Nazis, Nazis, Nazis. But the United States government is happy to fund and arm and support governments that include and are influenced by actual Nazis. Are you, Yurii Sheliazhenko, are you endangering yourself speaking out against war?
Of course, when you speak against war in Ukraine, it is easy to be labeled as Russian sympathizer and so on. I always emphasize that in current conflict, Russia and the United States are both destructive sources, and if we talk seriously about achieving peace on Earth, we should understand that Russian nationalism and Russian imperialism, as well as American imperialism, are not will of Russian or American people. It just a system of manipulation of powerful and very wealthy people. If we talk about peace on Earth, we should understand that some old myths are not enough to be a sound and robust foundation for this dream, this plan about peace on Earth. For example, we have this traditional view of democratic peace, but it is anecdote. Why democracies don't wage war on one another? Because it is very easy to make a public opinion poll in which many people will vote that enemy is undemocratic force. Yeah. To denounce enemy as undemocratic, as yes. autocrat, it is very easy. What is democracy? Is it a formal procedure of voting when people vote for some politician well-funded which will continue to wage wars in interests of merchants of death? Or people scared by populists will vote for populists, and people who trust in unrealistic promises will vote for populists. Real democracy is democracy of knowledge, democracy of moral principles, of personal moral autonomies of people. Real democracy is non-violent democracy. I think good word for it should be nomocracy, rule of norms, of this self-restraint, of this culture of peace, non-violent life. Peace education, some technologies of non-violent public management and non-violent forms of private life. We need non-violent economies yes. Without structural violence. We need more than this myth of export of democracy yes. From United States, which is in fact just indeed. Export of hypocrisy.
Yurii Sheliazhenko is very well said. I wish we could go on for hours. We're out of minutes. Yurii Sheliazhenko is Executive Secretary of the Ukrainian Pacifist Movement. Yurii, thank you very, very much for coming on Talk World Radio.
Thank you, David, for the opportunity to speak up.
This is Talk World Radio. I'm David Swanson. Take action at rootsaction.org. Help end war at worldbeyondwar.org. Read or listen to today's Peace Almanac entry at peacealmanac.org. All past shows can be heard at talkworldradio.org. Talk World Radio is produced in Charlottesville, Virginia, and syndicated by Pacifica Network. There is no way to peace. Peace is the way.